Good morning, everybody. And welcome to Gala Baptist Church. Welcome if you're on Zoom or if you're on YouTube later in the week. And it's lovely to see you all. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this amazing day on which we can praise your name and works and worship you. Lord, be in our midst and accept our offerings to you. Amen. I'd like to read you a psalm to start with. It's Psalm 136. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. His love endures forever. To him who alone does great wonders, his love endures forever. Who by his understanding made the heavens, his love endures forever. Who spread out the earth upon the waters, his love endures forever. Who made the great lights, his love endures forever. The sun to govern the day, his love endures forever. The moon and stars to govern the night, his love endures forever. And that's a wonderful testimony that we can share with our friends and neighbours every day and that we can praise God for. We're going to worship now.
Thank you.
Abe's going to come and do the intercessory prayer, please.
Come into God's presence now. Our gracious and our loving Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for this new day that you have given us, Lord. As we entered into this building, we've been seeing the sun shining. Lord, we thank you, even as we've been reading from the psalm, as we started this worship, you have given us this promise, Lord, that the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. We want to thank you. There are many things that we want to thank you this morning, Lord, to have that sunshine. Lord, we want to thank you for the children who've been out and about to have a good time in Newcastle town, and that you kept them safe, that they had so much fun, and also an opportunity to get to know one another in a very personal way. We want to give you thanks. We thank you that we have a God who is a Father. You are also a loving Father. Father, we want to thank you for Jesus, who died for our sins, the just for the unjust, that we can come back to God, that you made a way for us, Lord. That's the theme of Wayfinders, that Lord Jesus, the children will see Jesus as the way, as the truth, and as the life. The Bible says, no man can come to the Father unless but through Jesus. Lord, we know that you opened our eyes to see this truth. And Lord, you have put this truth in our heart that we would like to pass it on to our children and to our children's children. To know God as a Father. What a blessing to call God Father. Thank you, Lord, that you have and we have identity. Every person, no one is a stranger. That we have a God. The Bible says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon each one of us assembled in this building, that we should be called children of the living God. Thank you for that promise, Lord. You're a good God. Lord, we thank you for this service that we could gather together this morning. People who have come, for those who have come for the first time, we pray your blessing upon them, Lord. In Jesus' name, Father, we also pray this for the service, for the sermon. We especially remember Sylvia, for the time that she's been spending in your presence. We pray your blessing upon her too, and your anointing, Lord, will be upon her, that you'll put your words in her mouth. And as we, Lord, sit in your presence to listen to the ministry of your word, that you will prepare our hearts, Lord, that it will be open to receive the word that you have for each one of us. You know our needs, and only you can meet each one of our needs. And we thank you for it, Lord. Be with us throughout this day for this service by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Let's just pray for the children and they'll be going out during the next song. Father, we thank you for the children that you've given us. Lord, I thank you for the teachers and the helpers. Lord, I thank you that the word that's planted today, Lord, would enrich their lives, Lord, and encourage them in their lives. Lord, that it would teach them what they need to know. And Lord, I pray that through the things that they hear, Lord, they'll worship you. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. To the deepest valley he will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome him, not I, but through Christ in me. Fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and he was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold,
that Christine gives follows on from the disciples having come back from a successful missionary trip where Jesus sent them out in twos into the villages to heal the sick and to preach about about God and his kingdom.
The Bible reading this morning comes from Mark chapter 6, verses 30 to 44 to begin with, all right? And it's a story of where Jesus feeds the 5,000. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching many things. By this time, it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is the remote place," they said, "and it is already very late. Send the people away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered, "You get them something to eat." They said to him, "That would take 8 months of man's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" "How many loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people to sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples to set before the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of men who had eaten were 5,000. And then our second reading is just a couple of verses from chapter 10, Mark chapter 10, verses 43 to 45. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that those who are regarded as rulers of Gentiles lord it over them, and their high official exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Among you, not so with you. Instead, who wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first among must be a slave to all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Amen.
Thank you, Sherry, for your leading this morning, and thank you, Christine, for reading God's word to us. Fantastic. Wasn't that video of Wayfinder just wonderful? Isn't it good that there are talented people, anointed people who can put on events like that, that just hit the spot for youngsters and children? I can't wait until next week to hear from our young folk what they made of it. But they certainly looked as though they were enjoying themselves. While they were doing that, we were enjoying ourselves here, weren't we now? Yes. We were thinking about discipleship with others, about how we're called to journey together with one another, each of us with our L plates on. I meant to bring my L plates again and wave them around, but I forgot. I suggested that each of us in this life are wearing our L plates of discipleship. And I know that you've got your L plates on because you're still here. We're all learning until the day we leave this earth. We looked at a good number of verses from Mark 6, and this week we're continuing in this same chapter. It's a chapter all about being a disciple. This week our theme is discipleship, not with, but for others. And we are going to look at that very, very well-known story that Christine read for us, the feeding of the 5,000. Versions of it appear in all 4 Gospels. That's probably why we are so familiar with it. But Mark's account is just slightly different, leading some people to think that actually what he was reporting on was a completely different story to the rest of them. So, for instance, you might have spotted that there was no wee boy bringing his packed lunch in Mark's account. Now, there's a problem when we approach familiar stories. We can get rather blasé about it because we've heard it so many times. And those of us that have been in church for a long, long time, we've probably heard hundreds of sermons on this particular story. Bonhoeffer, that famous German theologian, he suggests that it's as we are drawn into the Bible that there we find that there are delights to be discovered. And as we're drawn in, then we can hear God as if he was talking to me and to you, to us as a community of believers. So that's what I'm going to do today, to try and attempt to draw us all in to that story, to see what God might want to say to us individually and together as God's people. So imagine being a disciple at that very moment when this wonderful miracle happened. Mark tells us that there were 5,000 men. That probably means that in total there was maybe 10,000, 15,000, maybe even more. Imagine, that's the size of the population of Galashiels. Imagine that number of people gathering on that hillside, all of them hungry, but none of them wanting to go home because they are so captivated with the teaching of Jesus. The disciples managed to come by 5 loaves. Now, it wouldn't be loaves as we know loaves. It would have probably been five of these kind of things, something a little bit like a pita bread, and 2 smoked or dried fish. They've brought them to Jesus to show him that that's, of this whole multitude, that's the only food that is available. And I'm sure they were probably making the point that, come on, Jesus, that piddly amount can't possibly feed all those people. And they watch as Jesus lifts the bread to heaven and thanks God for it and asks for God's blessing on it. And then he breaks the bread and the fish as well, and he starts to pass it to them. And you know what? It's at that moment. It's at that moment that the miracle happens. As he breaks it, miraculously, amazingly, somehow it replicates. And each time he breaks a little bit of bread, another bit appears. And the same happens with the fish. And something else remarkably happens, that they're in this very remote place. It's almost like a desert. But at that moment, it's as if green grass appears. And it's as if flowers appear. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul, and he prepares a table for me. That meal of humble bread and fish suddenly becomes like a feast, where people sit and recline in groups as though they were at a banquet. And what's more, there's enough food and more for absolutely everyone. And you know, if I'd have been one of those disciples, I'd have been in utter amazement. My jaw would have hit the deck. I'd have taken hold of the bread and felt it to make sure it was real. I'd have smelt it. I'd have tasted it. Maybe I'd have done the same with the fish as well, but then maybe not. And then to see everyone, everyone, from the littlest to the biggest, from the youngest to the oldest, all of them celebrating, eating at this banquet, at this feast, because that was what the atmosphere was like. I'd have been lost in wonder and awe. And then to have gone round and taken, as a disciple, taken my basket and collected a basket load. More than enough to satisfy my hunger. I'd have been amazed. Wow. But that's not what Mark records. He somewhat downplays all that side of the event and almost deals with all of that in a really matter-of-fact kind of a way. Why? Why? Why does he do that? What's going on? We get the impression that how Mark has documented this story, that the disciples were aware that a miracle was happening, had happened, but somehow they'd missed the joy of it. They'd missed the significance of what was going on that day. As I said at the beginning, this chapter, this section in Mark's Gospel is all about discipleship. How this bunch of 12 ordinary, very rough, very ready kind of men were being shaped and challenged to become like Jesus. So let's backtrack. As Sherry told us, that the disciples had just come back from that missionary journey that we were thinking about last week, where they'd been sent out in twos, doing discipleship with others. They'd gone with no bread, no food, no money, no spare clothes. A picture of extreme poverty to do the things that they'd seen Jesus doing, healing the sick, preaching about the kingdom, and so on. They'd got back tired. I bet you got back tired on Sunday, didn't you, Cherry? Yes, yeah. They come back tired, but with stories to tell. Yes, stories to tell. And then they'd started to share with each other and with Jesus what had happened, what they'd seen being done and what God was doing through them. But there was a problem. The problem was people. People kept coming and coming to Jesus and interrupting and disturbing their time together, so much so that they didn't get a chance to even eat. I think I can almost feel their irritation and their frustration. And Jesus recognized that. He had compassion on them. And so they set out for this remote, deserted, almost like a desert place by boat. But there was a problem. What was the problem? It was people. When they got there, when the boat inched up to the shore, there were people everywhere. In fact, there were thousands of people, even in this deserted, in what should have been a deserted, remote place, there were people everywhere. People rushed forward, eager, clamoring to speak to Jesus, to touch him, to take hold of him, to hear what he had to say. They'd run from every town and every village around. Although the place was like a desert, it by no means was deserted. There was noise and there was commotion. But Jesus seemed to take it in his stride. He wasn't fazed or frustrated. No, he was moved. He was moved with compassion, almost brokenhearted. He felt it in his innermost being. He, the good shepherd, who lays down his life for the flock. He saw the sheep around him and he saw that they were sheep without a shepherd. And there's one word for sheep without a shepherd? Lost. So he sets about teaching them about God and his kingdom. And we get the impression that this went on for rather a long time. Have you noticed? There's no mention of the disciples whilst that is happening. I wonder where they are. Are they resting somewhere? Are they having a nap? Are they watching their master at work to get tips and clues as to how they were to do it? Or are they observing from a distance, becoming ever more frustrated, thinking that this was our time. This was meant to be for us. What do you think? The next time that we do hear about them is when they come to Jesus. We kind of get the impression that they interrupted Jesus. Jesus. They'd kind of got the impression, made their mind up that it had gone on long enough, thank you very much. And they were coming to him with a problem. And what was that problem? It was people. They decided that it was late enough and that everyone was hungry. Did you notice their solution to this people problem? It was send them away. But we know that Jesus had other ideas involving 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Have you noticed at that point in the story that the disciples have come to Jesus as a group? It's not one or two, they've come, the disciples. You see, they'd slipped into a way of being and doing called groupthink as a substitute for Godthink. I'm sure they no doubt congratulated themselves for reading the situation and identifying the problem and coming up with a solution. I'm sure they thought they were being good leaders there. But actually, they'd taken their eyes off God. They'd become distracted. They'd forgotten God's calling on their lives. And they failed to see that Jesus had come to serve, not to be served. And that they, as disciples, were to do the same. In fact, they forgot quite a lot of things that day. They forgot that famous story of old of God's care and compassion for his people Israel, when Israel found herself in a desert place with no food. God wondrously provided manna and quail in just the right quantity to sustain his people. They'd forgotten too that just before they'd been sent out with no bread. And God wondrously provided for all of their needs. You would have thought that they would have been questioning, surely God will do the same here today. But they'd forgotten kingdom values, instead relying on human economics. Too many people, too much of a need, too few of us, no money, not enough food. I wonder, do we sometimes Do we sometimes do the same? Take our eyes off Jesus, become distracted with what is happening with us and our own lives, see people as problems, employ human economics instead of kingdom values, forget that our calling is to be disciples of Jesus, to serve and not to be served. Our discipleship, much like, just like the discipleship of those disciples, is for others. For others, that they may experience the kindness and compassion of God, and may through us come to know God and be drawn into his story that will culminate in a heavenly eternal banquet where together we will all enjoy the richest food and the finest wine in the presence of the Good Shepherd who came to seek and to save the lost, and did so by becoming the lamb that was slain. And on that day, we will fall in awe and wonder and worship at his throne. Oh, what a day that will be. But before that, there's work to do. There's a harvest to be gathered. And each and every one of us is involved in that task. Let's pray. Just spend a moment capturing whatever it is, wherever that troubling grace was this morning, wherever that finger of God was on your life this morning. Capture that moment. Remember it. Note it. And take that away. And ponder on it and pray on it in the hours and the days ahead. But let's pray together. Lord God, maker of heaven and earth, we come to you as a bunch of disciples, learning how to love and live and work together as a community of believers, learning what it is to be Christ-like before you and in this world around us. Forgive us. Forgive us for the times that we are blind to the people around us. Forgive us when we are tempted to turn away. Forgive us, perhaps, when we even blatantly refuse to reach out to the people around us, that we see people as problems. Would you help us to balance our own needs as human beings for food, nourishment, and rest? Help us to balance those needs against what you are calling us to do and be. Help us not to become so entrenched in meeting our own needs that we forget the calling that you have upon our lives. Would you help us to stay close to you? That we may become more like you, Lord Jesus Christ. That we may learn your ways. That we may become the people that you want us to be. And that we would be ever ready to do what you want us to do. And we thank you. We thank you that we have got that picture of eternity. That you want absolutely everybody into your kingdom. Everybody everywhere. Oh, Father, motivate us by the picture of that eternal banquet where we can celebrate before your throne and eat and dine together, banquet together, feast together with the finest of food and the richest of wine. So would you fill us by your Holy Spirit now? Would you make us more Christ-like? Would you help us in this task of discipleship for others? May your kingdom come. May your will be done in all that we do and say. In Jesus' name, amen. The worship team are going to come and lead us now in a well-known song. And It's a bit of a prayer. What I would say to you is, be mindful of the words that you sing this morning, because there are some tough words in this song. Here I am, wholly available. Wholly available. Let's make this prayer our earnest prayer this morning. That we are ready, those labourers ready to go out because the harvest fields are ready for harvesting. Thank you, worship team.
Peace to the brothers and sisters, and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to all who love our Lord Jesus Christ with an undying love. Amen.